Well, good morning, audience. At the AAPS in-boot presentation on lipid formulation development, I will present together with my colleague Martin Piest around lipid formulation development and the different aspects. The first part of the presentation will deal with the general aspects of lipid formulation, and Martin will address the specifics of actually how we perform lipid formulation development. First, why do we actually need a lipid formulation? And it starts all with the problem of poor bioavailability. So it's estimated that currently approximately 70% of the current molecules exhibits a poor solubility, and thereby is affecting the bioavailability. There are of course multiple formulations options feasible to actually overcome the bioavailability issue, but one of the challenges companies have is how do you select the right formulation moving forward. The other part is that you don't want to approach lipid formulation development in an ignorant way, so you would like to link API properties together with formulation properties to make the best selection of the technology available. So, as explained, the first question is of course, why do we need a lipid formulation? Why is this an issue moving forward? So I show you some literature references showing what the reason is for product failure, mainly in phase one. So this is quite an old reference, looking at a innovation by 7 UK owned pharmaceutical companies. I looked at the attrition rate of formulations. And what you actually see is that the third most important reason is actually for product failure is pharmacokinetics and bioavailability. This is another study done, published in 2015, where you can also see that pharmacokinetics is a major reason why drugs fail actually in early clinical development. So bioavailability is a real issue moving forward, trying to solve some of the issues around getting good clinical readings. And this is the last study, again showing the same trends, that pharmacokinetics or bioavailability is an important reason why products actually fail in early formulation development. So definitely having a poor bioavailable compound may hamper proof of concept of early phase developments, and actually might give you incorrect readings of your clinical studies. So what solutions are out there to actually overcome bioavailability through formulation options? So what you see here are the different options that have been utilized the last decades to overcome bioavailability. The one which is used the most is actually lipid formulation, but also you see that solid dispersions are gaining more and more interest to overcome bioavailability. Nanocrystals and amorphous drugs also have their place in overcoming bioavailability, but are less utilized, mainly because of the complexity of making this into a final dosage form or the limitations around stability of amorphous drugs without further stabilization. One of the goals of formulation development is also to actually establish relationship between molecular properties and developability. And one of the older publications, which is based on the Lipinski rule of 5 in the late 90s, was actually based on the following criteria. So it was thought that if you have a log P not greater than 5, a molecular mass not greater than 500, not more than 5 hydrogen bond donors, and not more than 10 hydrogen bond acceptors, you would have a good chance of meeting clinical efficacy, or at least clinical readings. This rule actually has led to a conclusion that many of the molecules selected in early development were actually based on this rule. So chemists actually optimized molecules to apply to this rule. However, since then, there's been multiple updates of this rule, actually showing what are potential other parameters to involve. And this actually publication coming from 2014, where you actually see that the Lipinski rules of 5 says that if you have a molecular weight below 500, you can actually not have a proper opportunity in development, but you actually see that there are a lot of molecules which actually don't apply to the rule of 5 and are in clinical development, either for oral or parenteral use. And actually some of them have been approved by authorities. So definitely the Lipinski rule of 5 is limiting some of the options. The other part Lipinski rule of 5 doesn't talk about is what kind of formulation would you need to overcome bioavailability. And that's what I'm going to talk about in the next few slides. So this is an overview of solubility of different drug substances and the lipophilicity expressed by log P. And what you actually see is the majority of molecules are in the phase in the middle, where you see some molecules on the outside. What you can also see is by the red and black dots is what kind of formulation has been used to overcome bioavailability challenges. I hope it's clear from this figure that just looking at the solubility and LogP doesn't give you much information about which formulation to select. So you see, for example, the point here, which have the similar properties with respect to solubility and lipophilicity, you see different formulations have been used. And if you look at more detail in these three molecules, you actually see that they differ. The main difference actually between the molecules is melting point next to the pKa. So these actually are additional molecular properties which actually determine what kind of formulation should I use. So I think I explained that molecular properties are important for formulation selection. But how do you actually utilize these molecular properties in selecting the right formulation? And that's actually what we do with our group in Bend, Oregon, and Patheon, where we actually do molecular modeling to actually link molecular properties to things like solubility, but also food effect and lymphatic transport. So we're currently exploring also alternatives. The way it actually works is actually that we translate 1D molecular structures to 3D structures with evaluation of different charges on the molecule surface. The other part we actually do when actually going through a potential formulation evaluation is look at the properties of your molecule. And based on that, we can actually make a pre-informed decision about which formulation have a high chance of meeting your endpoint and which formulations are less likely to achieve. So the different properties we actually look at are here. And for example, a very obvious one is thermal stability. So if you have a low thermal stability, it actually means that hot melt extrusion is probably not the right formulation to move forward with. The other part, which is very important, of course, is lipid solubility. Having a poor aqueous solubility doesn't mean that you also have a good lipid solubility. So if you look for a lipid formulation, one of the initial things we look at is actually solubility in lipids, either through molecular modeling or through screening different excipients. So one of the important aspects is also unit dose. So if you have a lipid solubility above 50 milligrams per milliliter, I think you have a high chance of having a lipid formulation. Below, it's a lower chance. But again, it depends on what kind of dose you're looking for. So one of the actually utilizations of the modeling is actually to upfront estimate some of the solubility of molecules in common used lipid vehicles. And this is actually the approach we use. It's based on quantitative structure analysis relationship and actually tries to relate the structure of molecule with a lipid solubility. In the next slide, I will give you an example about how it actually looks like in detail. So this is an example. So this is an example of Kapmul, a much used oily vehicle for lipid formulation. And actually what you see is that the observed solubility is well correlated with the predicted solubility. So this gives you initial estimates about how well an API will dissolve in your lipid vehicle. And these models we don't run to replace experiments, but we actually run them to guide the experimentation when looking at different screens. The other part which can be very important is actually food effect. Lipid formulation work in a similar way as food. So they make use of the intestinal digestion system, and by that can actually improve bioavailability. So what we're currently also assessing, if there's a relationship between food effect and the ability to use lipids to overcome bioavailability challenges. And actually what you see is that if your dose number is higher than 50, meaning that your solubility is limiting the absorption, and also your clinical dose is higher than your projected maximum absorbable dose, you actually predict a positive food effect. You might wonder, what do we do with this kind of information? So why is it relevant that we have a positive food effect? What can it be, how can it be used for development of lipid formulations? And this is shown in the next slide. What you actually see here is a list of molecules which all show a positive food effect, ranging from BCS class 2 to 3 to 4. And what you also see is that of these molecules which has a positive food effect, in many cases there is also literature or internal experience that lipid formulations were able to overcome bioavailability challenges. In some cases, we didn't find any evidence, which doesn't mean there is no opportunity, but we simply did not have any experience or any literature references showing that. But it does show that if you predict a food effect for molecules, it's also highly likely that lipid formulations are a suitable enabling formulation to overcome bioavailability. This is the end of my part of the presentation. I'll hand over to my colleague, Martin Piest, who will think more about the experimental aspects around lipid formulation development. So, thanks.
So, thank you, Casper, for giving this introduction. I hope everybody can hear me. I'm extremely pleased that I'm allowed to tell a bit about the work I've been doing so far, to give some case studies on lipid formulation. So we used the model compound, in this case it's clotrimazole, and the goal was to have a high dose with improved and more reproducible bioavailability. So clotrimazole is an antifungal. It's typically dosed as a vaginal tablet, oral lozenge, or topical cream. However, it can also be used as a potential anti-malarial drug if it's administered orally. Doing so, it gives a poor and erratic absorption from the gastrointestinal tract. That means there's a lot of variability from one patient to the next, but also from one patient from one day to another. So the solubility in water is very low. The log P is around 6. That means it's a suitable candidate for lipid formulation development. We aimed for a target of 20% weight in the formulation, and then would make it suitable for a soft gel formulation. This was the approach that we took. So we were first looking at the best excipients to use for such a formulation. It should be an excipient with high solubility, with good chemical compatibility, which means that it should not react with the API. And we also looked at the potential of these excipients to keep the drug in suspension if you do aqueous dispersion studies. Then we are starting blending studies where we also look at the miscibility range of the excipients. And finally, we look at the real dissolution test in simulated gastric fluid as well as lipid digestion screening. So this is quite a crowded slide. Let me guide you through. If you would come to us with your molecule, then we would use our standard UHPLC methodology that was developed by my colleague. And it shows that this HPLC method is able to separate and analyze a variety of molecules in a high throughput, fast, reproducible way. So that means this method can be used to do a solubility screen very quickly, and that means we can generate a lot of data already in the very first week that we have a new API on site. So you see the example for paracetamol, carbamazepine, clotrimazole, praziquantel, all with different molecular properties that can be analyzed in a single with a single HPLC method. What we did is we added API into plastic tubes. We added excess of API to each excipient. We stored it at 37 degrees on a shaker incubator. After that, we centrifuged it for 15 minutes. We take the supernatant and we assay for content. We repeat the whole cycle after we stored the material overnight at 65. The reason for that is we want to look at the supersaturation effect, and we also get the first idea about chemical compatibility. So again, we are centrifuging and we're assaying the supernatant, and we do a dispersion test with this saturated solution to see how good the API is maintained in the dispersion. So we do that with an API in this fashion with about roughly 6 grams of API. We complete this work within 2 weeks and we get a huge amount of data in that 2 weeks. And this is shown in the next slide. This would be the excipients we would be screening. So we include medium chain triglycerides here at the beginning, various oils, different glycerol monoesters, other lipid surfactants, propylene glycol monoesters, PEG-based surfactants, and we screen all of them and we look for this saturation solubility. And you see the data in blue is the data generated at 37 degrees, and the data in red is the equilibrium solubility after this temperature increase. So in some cases, we know that increasing the temperature could have the supersaturation effect. And we know then already in formulation development that if we are looking for higher solubility in the dosage form, we can use a short temperature excursion to get to this very high solubilities. So as mentioned before, we were looking for 20 weight percent solubility. We didn't achieve that, but we were able to get up to 15% with specifically Caprolil 90. And this is an excipient we selected for formulation development. As mentioned, we also immediately look at if the excipient is able to maintain the drug in a solution upon aqueous dispersion. This is how it looks. Excipients give milky suspension, whereas others give a very opalescent solution, suggesting that there are nano droplets being formed. So we take also these observations into account when selecting the best excipient. So it is not only solubility, but also the properties that are helping the self-emulsifying properties of the formulation at a later stage. We started blending some of the excipients. We made more than 25 formulations. I'm showing here five of them that are most successful, where we did achieve this 20 weight percent solubility. We found that if we use a little bit of water in the formulation, we could achieve higher solubility. We were more or less activating the disinfectants. We blended Caprolil 90 with Labrazol, and we also studied the effect of a co-surfactant or stabilizer. What we did is we did three star studies to show that the API doesn't crash out of the solution at the later stage, which is very important because ultimately we want to develop for a soft gel. And if we have a clear soft gel, we don't want the API crashing out during the shelf life of the soft gel. So these five lead formulations were further progressed. In the first test, we did a dissolution in simulated gastric fluid in a type 2 USP dissolution bath. 2 gram in 400 milliliter. We do that at 37 degrees. We stir at 100 RPM. And then we see that a turbid coarse emulsion is formed. We don't see any precipitation. And then we take samples after 30 and 60 minutes, and we look at the recovery of clotrimazole in the aqueous phase after centrifugation. So the recovery is about 80%, which is actually fairly good. That means this formulation has the properties to keep the drug suspended emulsified in gastric fluid. So then we do the lipid digestion test. This is a standard methodology that is adopted from the lipid consortium. We use that test to be able to connect our results with the results generated in literature. In short, we made a simulated intestinal fluid at pH 6.5. We do 1 gram formulation in 40 milliliters of total media. We are going to do a pH stat titration, and we can monitor the consumption of titrant. That gives us a measure how far the lipid digestion reaction is progressing. So as mentioned, we put pancreatine as an enzyme that cleaves the lipid excipients into free fatty acids. The free fatty acid has surfactant properties, and that further enables the emulsification and the formation of nano-sized droplets for these formulations. We take samples every 15 minutes. We do a stop solution to inhibit the enzyme to prevent further hydrolysis in the sample. And we're going to centrifuge and assay what is in the supernatant. So this is how it looks. So in some cases, it becomes a very clear solution. I presented some case studies yesterday where that indeed was the case. For clotrimazole, it remains a milky suspension, suggesting that these droplets are in the micro range and not in the nano range. However, if we compare the results, we saw that after centrifugation, the recovery of clotrimazole is really, really low. And this is a very disappointing result. And you see that there's some slight variation, but on average, it's a very low recovery. We also looked at the particle sizes. Well, as we already see, it's a very coarse emulsion. And it shows that also by DLS, we don't have nano-sized particles. So then we had an idea. What if we would reduce the API load? So we made two controls, and those controls have not the stabilizer, not the cosurfactant, just Laprazole and Capriol 90. And we had a 5 and a 20 weight percent load of clotrimazole. We repeated the lipid digestion test, and if you now compare the data, we see that for the low load, we have a complete recovery of the API, whereas for the high load, it trashes out. And this is a very interesting finding, because even if you look at the total solubility, if you calculate that back from the data, then you see that we can have a 20-fold higher solubility of the API if we put less in the formulation. So this is all these factors you have to take into account in developing a lipid formulation. It's not just about solubility in the dosage form, but it's also about the performance. And if you now look at these results, then the expectation would be that for the control one with the low load, you would have a better pharmacokinetic response in the clinical setting than for the control two. So this was where I would stop for today. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them. And both Casper and myself, we are here to help you with any questions you have. And if you have a low soluble molecule and you would like us to develop a lipid formulation for you, please contact us, and we would be happy to tackle your molecule. Thank you.